Hello, my name is Taylor Ginter. We're interviewing with the Houston Asian American Archive. It is June 8th, around 9 in the morning.
I'm Stephen Loyd.
I'm Rose Poo.
And we're here in Rose Poo's house, which is off of Greenbrier near Rice University. So, Rose, can you please introduce yourself a little bit, like where and when you were born?
Well, I was born in Beijing in 1927. And actually, our family was inside the Forbidden City. But then afterwards, because that was 1927, the Republic of China already established, and Beijing was capital during the Imperial China. But when Republic China came over, they moved the capital to Nanjing. The word Jing means capital, and the Bay means north, and Nanjing means south capital. So they moved the capital, Republic China moved the government to Nanjing, to the south. But we remained stay in Beijing until I was 2 years old. My father had only one job in his life, was Bank of China. He worked for Bank of China. When he was 2 years old, Shanghai has developed such metropolitan economic center of China. So Bank of China moved to Shanghai. And my father had to move to Shanghai with the headquarter because he was the auditor for the bank. At that time, banking business was very, very new in China. And my father had to come to Shanghai first, get place for our family. And we had a large household. See, my grandfather, my paternal grandfather, was government official for the Imperial Palace. Where, in fact, I have his Mandarin Square on the wall to show you. He had to wear the court dress with the Mandarin Square in the front. And of course, after the revolution started and the imperial dynasty was destroyed, China became the Republic of China. And my grandfather lost a job. You know, all of a sudden he lost his income, his status, his everything. But he's so accustomed to the lifestyle we were used to. He insists we still have to, at that time, no automobile, just horse carriage. We had to have a horse carriage. We have to have servants, men servants, and maids, cook. And every child had each one of us had a nursemaid take care of us. And it was a large household. But then, after when we had to move to Shanghai, my mother has to disperse all these household, the servants, everything. And she took, I have three older sisters. And so I was 2 years old. Next sister was 6, 7, and the oldest was 13 years old. So my mother had to take a train from Beijing to Shanghai. At that time, it took 3 days and three nights. And it was unheard for a woman to travel that distance. You know, it's a big ordeal.
With four kids, too.
Four kids, too. And, but I think my oldest sister had a lot. She was 13. And so we moved to Shanghai. But then I remember we moved several times until we, Bank of China, built a huge compound for all the bank employees. And well, whoever wants to live there, most of them do. And they have several sections. One's the executive section, only 9 houses. And then in the front, huge iron gates, you know, black iron gates. And the one on the left side has a little gate for people to walk through. Only when automobile, at that time automobile just started, when I moved to Shanghai, it was already 1929, and Shanghai was a metropolitan city. And then they opened the big iron gate if the automobile came. But very seldom, very few people had automobiles. In my family, I only remember my grand uncle, my paternal mother's brother, had an automobile, but he was Bank of Shanghai's president. Mm-hmm. And in those days, if you have automobile, you always have a chauffeur. You never drive yourself. And so, and that go into the compound. On the left-hand side, there is a store. It's co-op store. You know, all this is for Bank of China employees only. And this is non-profit organization. You can buy soap, toilet paper, whatever you need from that store. And then right in front, it's a big yard. It's our exercise court for the school. Right behind this, it's elementary school. And I can remember so clearly, and many, many steps go up to the elementary school. Again, that's only for bank employees' children only. And the standard very high, because at that time, just about anybody who could read and write could teach. And but in that school, all the teachers had to be college graduate, which was very rare at that time. And down the first floor, actually almost like basement to me. It had a barber shop, we can get our hair cut, and it had a bookstore. We each have a little red booklet. It's anything I need, pencil, paper, notebook, whatever, textbook, I can go to that bookstore. It charged onto my booklet, and they put down how much. By the end of school semester, my parents paid the whole amount. And it works for all the students. And so, and then after the school, you go in, that's the exclusive 9 houses, you know. It's 9 houses, they connect together. One building, but it's individual house, roadhouse-like. Mm. And then going here, there are playgrounds, swings, merry-go-round, monkey bar, everything. And then the old section, they have four rows houses, four section. And then go in, the next one section is a new section. That's where we lived, in a new section. It's huge. And I can remember when you first go in, it's all concrete. And on the right-hand side, there were fountains. And on the left-hand side, there were apartment buildings. And at that time, five stories was very high. And I can remember we went up to the rooftop flying kites. And because there won't be any trees or telephone poles getting in the way. And we roller skate playing. And then the middle section, we live in the middle section. Again, it's like roadhouse. Our house is number 15, three-story high. And I saw some houses in San Francisco, exact the same floor plan. You walk in that staircase, and on the right-hand side is living room, in the back, dining room, and in the back, kitchen. Under the staircase, there's a half bath, and upstairs, two bedrooms. Then third floor, again, four bedrooms, I think. And it was very, very happy childhood. So I was saying, actually, I lived in a very sheltered life because all the people I associate was that area, in, you know. And let's see. So that's where I lived until the war started. It was July the 7th, 1937, the night before we went to bed. The next morning, there's war, and it was exactly like Pearl Harbor. That's the way Japanese operates. And overnight, they bombed Shanghai, and the people just panic. And Shanghai had several sections, and my father was afraid the section we lived wasn't safe, move us to another section. And it was very nice house, but they didn't have electricity hooked on or anything yet. And my family saw, but I went to sleep. I guess I was exhausted. And the airplane with a ball of fire in the back and looked like it was going to drop right on top of our house, but it was dropped next street. So we were saved. It was bad.
So what do you remember? You said you were like sleeping, but what do you personally remember from that day?
Well, I remember my mother said, you pack your things, we are refugees from the war, we have to move. And I didn't know I had very few children have their magazines, but I did. And I remember I bundled up my little books, tied up. That was my possession that we were going to move. And so my father put me and my grandmother into this hotel. And it was bombing everywhere. And it happened to be my grandmother's birthday. All she was concerned about her birthday, She said, oh, we must have refreshments ready. People are going to come to greet me for my birthday, you know. And, but of course, we never could talk back to our parents or elders. And we couldn't even say you to the parents. It's mother this, father this, grandma this, and of course nobody came. And I could hear bombing everywhere, just two of us in the hotel. It was, and that was, see, that was Japanese war. See, actually, Chinese nationalists and the communists were fighting all the time, but you know, it didn't affect us. It's small war here and there, but never in Shanghai. But that was Japanese war. It's just like Pearl Harbor declared war to the whole country. And then finally we moved to one section, French control section. They feel it's neutral, safer. So we stayed there. And we stayed there, then World War II started in 1941. But for us, it was just war continuously for 8 years.
So you left the banking complex, then you were in a hotel for a bit?
For a hotel. And then we moved to another house. That's where we saw the airplane drop.
Okay.
And then we moved to the French section. We moved with my grand uncle and then another relative. Actually, three families live in that three-story house. And we lived until my father found another place nearby in the French section. And we moved there. That's where we stayed. And when we moved in, we had that three-story, it's huge Chinese-style story house. Before that, we had the Western-style housing.
Mm-hmm.
And but then, as war getting more intense, people everywhere moved to the French section. And again, that housing was belonged to Bank of China. We lived in there, wound up, the other families moved to Shanghai. I mean, they found Shanghai, but they want to move to this section too. My mother was very kind-hearted, let everybody move in. Finally, that house, we had 10 families live in that house.
Wow.
Yes, and it's, I can see the house and courtyard, and 10 families all share that one bed, kitchen, and each has little that size stove.
Mm.
And it's amazing. I never heard a fight or argument among the people.
Mm.
But then it got to where my uncle's wife and two children came to Shanghai, stayed with us, and it was really crowded. And it got to the way my cousins came. They all came to Shanghai to go to universities. All, and my uncle, my mother's half-brother, moved over. It was really crowded, but that was war, you know.
So everyone living there was some kind of family member?
What now?
Everyone living there was from your family?
Yes, yes. But in that house, not everyone in. They all bank employees.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We had this one. Finally, at first we just give up the top floor And then we had to give up the second floor. Then we give up the Rasa wing. Then we left, give up the middle part. We only got the left side, but it's like three sections. And then later on, we put a petition in, make more sections, little more privacy. It was bad.
So were you still going to school during this
time? Yes. But in China, for every year we went to school was private at that time. Now they have public school, the government paid for. So only, say, the privileged ones get to go to school. And I couldn't believe at that time, they say only 1% people were literate. Were educated, but the others not.
So was your school in the French concession area?
Yes. I had to move to that. And I had to go through a park. It's a shortcut to school. And in park, we have to pay, get a pass for the park, pay for it to go to park. Here, parks are free. And even now, I remember last time when I was in Shanghai to park, you have to pay. Mm. And I remember I went there early in the morning, all the people were all waiting outside, a whole crowd. And the gate man evidently see the familiar face, know all of them, let them in. But he knew I was a newcomer. He told me, no, you have to pay. And I didn't bring any money. Had to run back to the hotel, get the money to get in. And it was so crowded, the park. You know, you can't just... I practice Tai Chi every morning and for the past 30 years. And so I want go over there to Tai Chi. You could, if you do this, you're going to touch somebody. It's that crowded.
Wow.
It's the way it was.
So what types of people were your neighbors? Like, were there a lot of French people, people from other places?
In Shanghai, it's very much metropolitan city. You see a lot of different nationalities. And I remember this woman was white Russian. We call them white because when communists came over, they were the original aristocrats in Russia. The communists came over, they have to leave. They came to Shanghai. And I remember Portuguese. In fact, I don't remember I met any French people. But Indians, a lot of Indians were policemen. They wear the turban. They were policemen. And all different nationalities. Well, of course, mostly Chinese. And English was very popular.
When did you start learning English?
Well, yes. In Shanghai, in elementary school, third grade, you study I am, you are, he is, she is. And even today, I can't get he and she and it and all these things mixed up.
Right, because in Chinese, it's all the same.
Chinese all the same, the writing you can tell is, you know, woman. You don't have to.
Right.
It's different. Yeah, I just finished reading Amy Tang, Where the Past Begins. There's one section about the Chinese. Her mother had trouble with English, and I can really relate to that.
No, your English is very good, though.
Well, I've been here 70 years.
Yeah.
So I should
So after, or how long were you in Shanghai, in that area?
We moved there when I was 2 years old. By the time I was 20, I came to U.S. and I had 2 years college. And I went to Plainview, Texas, Wayland. At that time it's called Wayland College. It now it's Wayland Baptist University. But at that time only 300 or 500 students the most. And I came from Fulbright University, which is a big university.
Mm-hmm.
But it was very good training for me because go to a small city and they were very friendly, but I tried so hard to speak like Texan. And believe me, in West Texas, they talk like Texans. You all, I bet you they're saying that. And in Shanghai, the English we learned were British English. We say half glass, you know, class, party, patio, you know, it's, but I try so hard to talk like Texan. So later on, my relatives were laughing at me, you know, here's this Chinese woman speak English with Texas accent. But
so did you know anything about Texas before moving?
Oh, well, movies, American movies were very, very popular. And during wartime, especially in Shanghai, there's not much recreation except movies and dance. And that's about it, you know. So we saw a lot of movies. Of course, you see the worst. I mean, I don't mean worst, but and I can remember Annette Funicello, Beach Boys, those movies, and they think American people all act like that, which is not true, you know. A lot of American people are very serious, but anyway.
So what were you studying in university and why did you go?
When I started university, I can remember, by that time my father already died. My father died when I was 13 years old. And my mother had, we all sat at a table and she would decide what we, you know, we would discuss what should we major in. My older sister majored in office management or something like that. And my second sister studied economics. My third sister, she studied medicine. When I left China, she was doing internship. And then she became internist, became head of internist, and then she became vice president. When she retired, she's the president of the hospital. Yeah, and I'm the fourth one. And they decided, at that time, women really wasn't career-oriented. We just had to be educated, but more for a piece sheepskin in the dowry than anything else. But of course, an educated woman raised children different from an uneducated mother. And so we decided to study economics, which they didn't have aptitude test or any of these things. So I studied economics in the university. And by the time I came to States, I went ahead, had studied economics. So my bachelor's degree in economics. And then after I finished, I came to Baylor got my master's degree in business administration. So I have an MBA. And but when I was looking for a job, at that time, if you have college education, it was almost guaranteed you have job security. And here I was back in 1960, have an MBA in Waco, Texas. I couldn't get a job. I can't remember, people looked me in the eyes, why should I hire you? We have Americans without a job. You know, I wanted to tell them I work twice as hard. I do all the right things, but I was female minority and small in size, you know, just such disadvantage. See, when I first went to Plainview, Texas, they were some students from Mexico, couldn't even get a haircut in a barber shop. The president of the university had to take him to the barber shop, make them cut their hair because they're Mexicans. And I can remember the water fountain colored. At that time you have to say colored and white. And bathroom colored and white. And I said, well, I'm yellow, I'm not colored or I'm not white. They just said, mark you white, you know. So, and I never can forget when I came, of course, nobody could afford, not nobody. We couldn't afford to go to American schools in United States, you know. We had a scholarship to come, and I had to work in a school nursery. And I remember this four-year-old little girl look at me. She never saw a Chinese woman before. And she said, you're not colored, are you? I said, no, I'm not. And she was really puzzled, didn't know what I was, you know. But that. And at Plainview, the only foreigners were the school. I mean, there was another Chinese girl was there before we did. And when I came to Baylor, I can remember Baylor, the first football game always Baylor against Wake Forest. And they had a black football player on the team. When they came to Baylor to play, all the football players supposed to stay at the Roosevelt Hotel in Waco, Texas. That's the big hotel there. And the hotel wouldn't let him sleep there because he was black. It's quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now it's much more open, you know.
Mm-hmm. So how long were you in Waco after you graduated from your MBA program?
I lived in Waco 20 years. All my three children born in Waco, Texas.
Okay.
And then at that time, the only other Chinese family was another Chinese student, Chinese couple. There were very few Chinese there, yeah.
So did you, were you friends with the other Chinese couple?
Well, at first we was not really. But then when I had to have a job, I couldn't get a job as, at that time, job for women. Not, I don't care if you're black or white. Would bank, tailor, secretary, and school teachers. I think that's about, and waitresses and whatever. And so finally, when I couldn't find a job, I was desperate. And I decided I become a teacher because it's a better hour for a mother with small mm-hmm. children. And when I was going back, when I was looking for a job, one time I remember Pioneer Saving Association in Waco, close to us, very good location for me, and the old man named Taylor hired me on the spot. I got a job, and afterwards we were sitting there just talking. And of course, I talk about my favorite subject, my children. And he said, oh, you have children? I said, yes. And he said, how old they are? Well, the youngest one was just a baby. And he said, I'm sorry, we don't hire women with small children because they always call in, oh, my child has fever, my child's sick, I can't come to work, this or that. He said, we can't hire you. So I lost my job again.
Wow.
You know, and nowadays I could sue him. But anyway, so I decided I'd become a school teacher. I had master's degree and I had to get education courses and American history, American geography, you know, American Constitution, all that. And then, so I thought, well, I have a job security. When I apply job, no, you can't. You don't have American citizen. Mm. So I had to go through the whole process, try to get American citizenship. And I remember we have to have friends came to sponsor us, whatever it is, you know, to get us to get a citizenship. Then I became a teacher. So with a master's degree in business, I wound up became an elementary school teacher.
So did you have a student visa before when you were studying, and that's how you were here?
When I first came, I was economic delegate from the government because connection, you know. And I looked like a child, but anyhow, I got in and then changed to student visa and then changed into permanent residence. But I didn't have citizenship until 1963. And after that, I started teaching. I taught 17 years.
Elementary school.
I taught fifth grade. Again, they say, oh, she has an accent. You know, it's bad to teach lower grades I'm small, so it's better for me to teach little kids because I don't have to overlook them. But I mean, look up to them. But then the thing I remember, the professor said, no, small children probably will imitate her accent. So it's better for her to teach fifth grade. And so I taught fifth grade.
Were you the only foreign teacher at that school?
Yes. And I remember the principal was very hesitant to have me. My children went to the school nearby, and that school was nearby, but it's not I cannot teach the same school my children go to. But I'm familiar with the school over there. And usually when you have a new teacher at the PTA, the principal will introduce the new teacher. And he never introduced me. And then I remember I finished my student teaching November the 15th, I think, that 6 weeks student teaching finished, then I was done. And I thought, well, I will not get a job until at least in the spring. Not so I came home, I was making sewing a dress. That was Friday, Saturday morning in the mail, say you hired a report to work on Monday. I was glad, but so I had hurry, brush, finish making the dress, and then report to work. And they put me, the first month, they must put me in three different classrooms. They put me in this classroom, they changed me to another classroom. And I just got the names memorized, you know. And then they moved me again, but finally they put me there. And then, like I said, principal never introduced me to PTA. And finally, the PTA president's daughter happened to be my oldest daughter's good friends. They were playing together. So Mrs. Thompson was telling my principal, say, aren't we lucky we have Mrs. Shea in our school? Then the principal feel much more at ease. And then he started to introduce me to the PTA. Then I was thought more accepted.
Do you have any questions?
You said earlier that they said like marked you down for white rather than color because there was this kind of like binary distinction that you had to make. How strange was that?
What?
Like being, choosing white instead of colored, even though you said you considered yourself yellow, was that weird?
They just check a white. I don't know why because I guess I'm closer to white than black.
So was that a weird feeling for you?
Well, it got to the way after I lived in States so long, I consider myself American. I really don't even think of my race. But because my looks, right away people say, you know, you Chinese, you know, or at the airport they will say, do you speak English, you know.
So during the 60s, obviously there was a lot of like civil rights movements for colored people?
No. We just took it. And I think Chinese people are extremely tolerant. I can remember, see, I wanted to have an English minor. And I can remember my English teacher, Mrs. Warren, she, every day, I had to write a paper. And I grew up during wartime in Shanghai. There was no reference book, no library. It was, you know, chemistry has no lab, and I never wrote a paper before. And no one taught me. So I just slave over doing this. And that class was so small, I think 7 students. And every day we hand our paper over, she would read to the class, and she threw my paper on the floor. I was so humiliated. I never can forget that. But then you live and learn. And every course, like studying 2 courses, English economics, English government, you know, because, and eventually you learn the terminologies and you get by. I never could get an A in English. The best I could get was a B in English, no matter how hard I tried. People in Hong Kong seem like they the English stand up much higher. Mm-hmm.
So you said, I mean, you've lived here for so long. What did you do to preserve your Chinese heritage? Like, did you teach your kids about your background?
I tried so hard to teach my oldest daughter Chinese. When she was little, I was determined she learned Chinese first. I figured when she starts school, she'll learn English regardless. And until she was 3 years old, it really just did not work well, because the babysitter comes, couldn't understand her. You know, she couldn't play with the other kids. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they play very well without communicate somehow, kids. And then, so I decided she has to learn English and Chinese. So everything I say twice, the first thing, first time in Chinese and then in English, then the Chinese just gone. Just they stay as English because they play with the other kids, they go to church.
So were you involved with your church? Are you religious?
Yeah, I was involved in Baptist church, yes. But now, because my poor hearing, impaired hearing, I really don't go to church anymore because I can't hear. I mean, I hear noises, but I cannot distinguish the words very well. I have to be close one-on-one and depend on the person's pitch and tone of voice.
So when did you start practicing baptism, or like being Baptist?
Well, my family were Buddhists, and I still have a whole lot of respect for Buddhism. And then I did go to Baptist church, and I was religious. But then now I'm just retired, you know, just.
Yeah. So how, you said you were a school teacher for 17 years, and then that was all in Waco.
No, not all in Waco.
Not all in Waco.
I taught 13 years in Waco. It got to the way I was well accepted. You know, they really liked me. And then I taught in Corpus Christi for 4 years. Then I went to Scotland. You know, and I liked that. That was very good experience. And I really like Scottish people. Again, I taught in Bathgate, which is a small town between Edinburgh and Glasgow, and which I really like it. And I like my landlady. She was treating me like her daughter. Mm-hmm. And it was, and I learned my landlady's spunky spirit, you know, and it was cold. I can remember she go to fish market, buy fish, and it's hilly, and she would have one hand, a bag. You go to grocery store, you bring your own bags. The first time I didn't know, I went to the grocery store, wound up, I put fish, everything in my pocket.
Oh no. You know?
And then my landlady says, no, you always bring bags. So I brought my bags with me, but even bags, cardboards, caught them very rare. You can't find them, you know. And then she also taught me, no matter how warm it looks, you always bring an umbrella and have a scarf. So I always did that. But it was so funny, I went to church and I saw the first two rows and the school teacher with all these little boys, two rows, they just packed. And, you know, they couldn't, it was, I mean, the teachers over there, evidently, they not just teach during weekdays. They take them to church on Sunday too. And I thought it was tough when we were teaching. We had to monitor the dining room, you know, that lunch hour really not free. You still watch over the kids. But they do even weekends.
So you went to Scotland through a Fulbright.
Yes.
Can you talk about the program?
Yeah, it's well, my girlfriend, another school teacher from different school, gave me this Fulbright program thing. And I thought, well, I will apply for it. But by that time, I think the deadline was October 1st or 15th, whatever it was. By the time I turned in, it was little late, one day or 2 days afterwards, I couldn't. And I thought I wouldn't get it. But anyway, they called me for interview. Four different people have to interview you. And then, and I remember one person said, you are perfect candidate for this program, except your age. I was too old. I was 57 years old. Well, if I don't get it, I don't get it. Well, anyway, so I was really surprised when I got it. And they assign you, you know. I was in Bathgate, I thought it was cold. But then a friend of mine was assigned to Edinburgh. That was really cold. She said she had to say a prayer before she take a bath. It was so cold. And my landlady had, at that time, electric blanket was popular. They didn't have electric blanket, but she had a sheet. It's not a whole, it's maybe 3 feet long and 1 foot wide, put under the sheet bed.
Oh.
And to keep me warm. But I remember, you know, even, you know, I'm from Texas, and I put wool socks on my feet in the winter, I mean in the summer, in August to bed. My landlady said, what you gonna do? And the water, bathroom water faucet, cold and hot. You know, so finally I went to a hardware store, bought one of these things, hook on the hot water and cold water, come out together so I can have warm, you know, wash hair. It was interesting.
Did you apply for Scotland specifically, or they assigned you to go there?
They assigned me, yeah. And my landlady, at that time, Dynasty, the TV show, was very popular. And I remember people say, who killed JR? Who killed JR? I didn't even know who was JR. I didn't watch Dynasty, you know. But anyway, it was very interesting. And Scottish people speak quite different from other people. From the British, and even the islands, Irish talk a little different too. Of course, Welsh has a total different language almost. And I remember as soon as I got to Scotland, we went to this restaurant. It's called Copper Tin, beautiful place. I walk in, I just ordered a hamburger. Somebody, Scottish people, came to me and said, are you an American? I thought, you know, I was so surprised because when I was in the States, people said, when I first came, they said, you Jap, you Japanese. I said, no, I'm not. Then during Vietnam War, they said, you Vietnamese. I said, no, I'm not, you know. And people were, you Korean, you, you know, I'm, nobody ever asked I was an American. I thought, oh, I have come to Scotland to become an American. And when I was walking on Edinburgh, somebody asked me direction. I thought, oh dear, they think I'm... It was interesting.
So did you feel welcomed in Scotland?
Yes. That's what I like about small town. People are very sincere. I call the Scottish a very real people, not this phony, superficial thing. And my landlady, I have a lot of respect for her. And she's very routine that she and her husband run a flower shop. So every morning, and I can sit, I have one room and the kitchen privilege and the living room privilege. And for telephone, every time if I make a phone call, I put 12 pence in this little can by the phone. And I pay $20 a week for my, £20 a week for my rent. So 1 month, just 80 pounds. And at that time, US dollar was very high, US currency. So us, that was the period I started saving money. Before that, I never could really save money. And my landlady, you know, I remember every night, 10 o'clock, we sat watch TV news. She will have one glass milk and two cookies. And then 10:30, she closed the tin can, finish her cookie and milk, go to bed.
How long were you in Scotland?
I was in there actually just a few months. Mm-hmm. And I came back. Oh, I was there during the coal strike, coal mine strike. And I feel the tension in the air. I didn't know what was going on. And in the teacher's lounge, I heard they talk about industrial action. And I had no idea what was industrial action. And finally came industrial action means strike. The teacher was going to have a strike. And I didn't know whether I should strike or not strike or what. So I called the American embassy, you know, Fulbright's related to that. And they told me, you go teach, but do not cross the picket line. Mm-hmm. So I did. So I went there. Some classrooms were empty. Some classrooms were full. Some teacher teach, some teacher on strike. That was interesting. Yeah. And my landlady was saying her grandson, Jonathan, 11 years old at that time, she said, well, Jonathan has no future. Living in Bathgate, he grow up to be a coal miner. Mm-hmm.
So, during Scotland, like your kids were already grown up?
Yes, they're all in college. I wouldn't apply, you know. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yes. Yeah. And, but yeah, they're all in school.
And then you returned to the U.S. afterwards?
Yes, I returned. And I went back to the same school to teach. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I ran to my principal at the administration office in the school districts. And he's so glad to see me back. You know, so.
So how did teaching in Scotland help you teach in America?
The children over there are very nice. They're not as sassy as the children here. And I have students say, well, look at my face, say, look, I can get you fired. You lose your job, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, in Scotland, they would never do that. They're very well behaved. And I can remember this little girl had a flowers wrapped in a wet paper bag, holding her hand, came to school in the morning, and then came to my dad, put up the desk, go sit down. You know, it's kind of shy, but they very sincere. And this little boy, I still have the 2 pieces of soap that he gave to me. I'm sure it's very expensive to him. And he just, when I was leaving, he just cried, you know. His parents are much older and doesn't seem they understand him and all that. And the Scottish food is not the best, but anyway, but the dietitian was so nice to me, you know. And I say, oh, this is good. So next time she give me twice as much. I had to eat more. And the funny thing is, they can serve you cake. It can be a week old, just hard as rock. They pour the pudding sauce over it. And after 30 minutes, it's soaking. It's all soft, edible, you know. And they say, oh, you have to eat haggis. So that's the ghost stomach stuff, all these. Oh, you have to drink Scottish whiskey. And what surprised me was lunchtime. We will have a lunch. And teachers all drink. And I thought, they have to go back teaching in the afternoon. They do. And they love their tea in the morning. 10 o'clock, you drop everything to have tea. 4 o'clock in the afternoon, drop everything to have tea. And one time I was in the house, my landlady ran in to the house and thought, oh, she had to go to the bathroom in a hurry. Where she went to the kitchen, put the teapot, because it was 4 o'clock. But they say tea, you know, it calms you and all that. But and at the Edinburgh airport, I met this American guy. He had a bike. It's a folding bike. And he said he was just grumpy and grubby and fussing. And he said, well, I travel all over Europe on my bicycle. He said, I had a French in high school, but I didn't have trouble until I come to Scotland. I can't understand a word they're saying. They say so I was telling my landlady that. My landlady said, oh, you know, it's terrible. Milk is milk, you know, sweater is jumper. and then she said, good day, not good day. You know, that's a lot of them talk that way. It took me a couple of months to learn to speak, to understand that.
Did they understand you with your Texas
accent?
Oh yes.
Okay. Because they watched Dynasty.
Okay. Do you have any questions?
So, when you left Scotland, were you back in Plainview teaching?
What now? About leaving Plainview? No, I stayed in Plainview for a year and a half, and then came to Waco, went to Baylor, and stayed in Baylor from 1949 to 69 or 70. 20 years, 69.
And then
I was in Corpus Christi 4 years. And it was when I was in Corpus Christi, I went to Scotland. So I came back to Corpus Christi. And then that was it.
So after Corpus Christi, where did you go?
I went to Missouri.
Missouri State?
Stayed 2 years away. I did not to Missouri. I say Missouri. And like Scotland, the natives call Edinburgh, they don't say Edinburgh, they say Edinburgh. And Missouri, the native Missouri, they don't say Missouri, they say Missouri. And I say it's Missouri. Then we retired to Florida. Mm. Then I lived in Florida for 20 years.
Mm.
Then, you know, my daughter lives here. And in Florida, I was very active with the Chinese.